SBK English Academy. In today's class, we will discuss Matthew Arnold, one of the most important critics of English language and also in English literary theory. See, after Dryden, Matthew Arnold was the great literary critics of English language. So, for the exam point of view, we will discuss or we will study Matthew Arnold as a poet and as a critic also. So, the questions are asked on his poems and also on his critical works and his critical ideas for the UGC NET and also KSET in English literature. So, if you haven't subscribed to my channel, please you do subscribe, because tomorrow onwards I am making the videos on cultural studies like formalism, feminism, post-structuralism, reader response theory and cultural study and like that. So every day that making the videos and sharing all the groups and all the people, all my friends, it is a great problem to me to do all these things. So that's why I'm humbly requesting you to, if my videos are informative and useful to you and these videos will help you to prepare well for the examination of UGC NET and KSET, so you do subscribe now. Tomorrow onwards, I am not interested to share the videos. I have no time to do all these things. So we study Matthew Arnold as both as a poet and as a critic. So we will discuss that Matthew Arnold as a poet when we will discuss the Victorian age. So Matthew Arnold was born in 1822 and died in 1888. Today we will discuss Matthew Arnold critical works, The Study of Poetry. It was published in 1888. The Functions of Criticism at the Present Time, 1864. Preface to the Poems of 1861. And also his critics' disinterestedness. So on this concept, disinterestedness, so in the last year KSET question, was asked a question, what do you mean by disinterestedness according to Matthew Arnold? You have to keep this point in your mind. So don't also confuse about the work, that Functions of Criticism at the Present Time, 1864. See, T.S. Eliot also wrote one critical work, that is Functions of Criticism. The T.S. Eliot's work is only the Functions of Criticism, but Matthew Arnold's work is The Functions of Criticism at the Present Time. So you have to remember these points. So we'll discuss all these in this video. What that Arnold particularly say in his Study of Poetry, Functions of Criticism and Preface to Poems, and also what do we mean by, what is meant by disinterestedness according to Matthew Arnold. Now we'll go to now. See, Matthew Arnold wrote many works. I told you we have to study him as a poet and also critic. Here we will discuss Matthew Arnold, or we will study here Matthew Arnold as a critic. So I told you after Dryden, John Dryden, that Matthew Arnold is the dominating and most influential critic of English language. See, the first critical work of Matthew Arnold is, that is Preface to Poems of 1861. See, in Preface to Poems of 1861, what that Matthew Arnold say? So we have to discuss here. What he said? See, in this work, he asserts the importance of architectonics, means the power of execution which creates forms and constitutes. In poetry, the necessity of achieving unity by subordinating the parts to the whole and the expression of ideas to the depiction of human action and condemns poems which exist for the sake of single lines or passages, stray metaphors, images, and fancy expressions. So in this preface to Poems of 1861, that Matthew Arnold says that he asserts about the importance of architectonic. What is architectonic means according to Matthew Arnold? See, architectonic means the power of execution, which creates forms and constitutes in poetry the necessity of achieving unity by subordinating the parts of the whole. So this is the meaning of architectonic according to that Matthew Arnold. See, next. So passages, stray metaphors, images, and fancy expressions. So these are also in this preface to Poems of 1861. See. And then that Matthew Arnold spoke about the excellences of Shakespeare and listed them. So according to Matthew Arnold, he studied Shakespeare and also he listed why Shakespeare is an excellent dramatist. See, he gave some reasons here. So that is, one is that, see, the architectonic quality of his style, the harmony between action and expression, one. And second one, his reliance on the ancients for his themes. Third one, accurate construction of action. Fourth, his strong conception of action and accurate portrayal of his subject matter. See, fifth one, his intense feeling for the subjects and he dramatizes. So these are the five important qualities which that Matthew Arnold found in Shakespeare. So he considers Shakespeare as excellent writer on the basis of these five points. See, and next what he says, he also wants the modern writer to take models from the past because they depict human actions which touch on the great primary of human affections to those elementary feelings and which subsist permanently in the race and which are independent of time. See, in this preface to Poems of 1861, Matthew Arnold said here, force the modern writers. What he posed? He posed the modern writers to take models from the past writers or the past works or the past poems because the past writers depicted human actions which touch on the great primary human affections. So that's why Matthew Arnold told the moderns, advises the modern or modern poets to take the models from the past. So that is. So next point is, according to Matthew Arnold, criticism should be a dissemination of ideas, a disinterested endeavor to learn and propagate the best that is known and thought in the world. So according to him, criticism means, what is that? It should be a dissemination of ideas, a disinterested endeavor to learn and propagate the best that is known and thought in the world. Already it is known and thought in the world. So that is the function of criticism according to Matthew Arnold. See, he says that when evaluating a work, when any critic evaluating others' work, the aim is to see the object as in it itself it really is. So when we evaluate others' works, we have to see it as it is the work, how that work is really. psychologically, psychological, historical, and sociological background are irrelevant. So when we look at the text, when we evaluate the other's text, so according to Matthew Arnold, so we have to look at only how is that work real. So what is the object of the work really is. So we have to look in that side. But we don't look at the side of a psychological or historical or sociological background of that text. So these psychological, historical and sociological background are not necessary. They are irrelevant when anyone or any critic evaluates the text. It means we don't consider the works psychological, historical and sociological background when we evaluate the text or when we have to criticize the other text. These are not necessary according to Matthew Arnold. See, next point, a critic should not confine or limit. Confine means limit. A critic should not confine himself to the literature of his own country, but should draw substantially on foreign literature and ideas, because the propagation of ideas should be an objective endeavor. See, here Matthew Arnold says in the preface to poems, so a critic should not limit himself to the literature of his own country. It means a critic should not study only his own country's literature. So instead of this, a critic should study the literature of foreigner or the literature of other countries, because the propagation or spreading of ideas should be an objective endeavor. For this sake, that Matthew Arnold said that you have to study the literature of the globe. See, next important work is the study of poetry. So it was published in 1888. It's very important work of Matthew Arnold. So many questions asked on this. It was asked for in matching, or some points are asked from this study of poetry from the exam point or in the examination of that UGC NET English and also KSET. See, what did that Matthew Arnold say in this work? What is the subject matter of the study of poetry? See, Arnold told that there is no place for charlatanism in literature. Someone who pretends to have special skills or knowledge used to show disapproval. Charlatanism means. So especially according to that Matthew Arnold, there is no chance, there is no place for charlatanism. There is no place for the persons who pretends to show that he has all the skills or all knowledge. So there is no place for that kind of writers or critics in the literature. See, used to show the disapproval. See, in poetry is the criticism of life. So this statement was asked in many previous question paper. Who said poetry is criticism of life? This question is asked in many question papers. Remember that point. See, poetry is the criticism of life, governed by the laws of poetic truth and poetic beauty. It is in the criticism of life that the spirit of our race will find its stay and consolation. See, according to that Matthew Arnold, poetry is criticism of life. So what is going on in the life, on the human being's life? So that is criticized in the form of the poetry. So that's why he said that poetry is criticism of life. See, the extent to which the spirit mankind finds its stay and consolation is proportional to the power of a poem's criticism of life. And the power of the criticism of life is in direct proportion to the extent to which the poem is genuine and free from charlatanism and artificial poetry. It means charlatanism, artificial poetry. See, next what he says in the study of poetry, see, he also cautions, he warns here, cautions means that that Matthew Arnold warns the critic that in forming a genuine and disinterestedness estimate of the poet under consideration, he should not be influenced by historical or personal judgment. Historical judgment being fallacious because we regard ancient poets with excessive veneration, means respect, and personal judgment being fallacious when we are biased towards a contemporary poet. So according to that Matthew Arnold, Matthew Arnold cautions or warns the critic. What he wants? So while he was criticizing any text, so that critics should not consider the influence of history or his personal judgments. So historical judgment being fallacious because we regard ancient poets with excessive veneration or respect. So that is the next point. If a poet is a dubious means if a poet is a doubtful person, classic, dubious classic, let us search him. If he is a false classic, let us explore him. But he is a real classic. If his work belongs to the class of the very best, enjoy his work. See how beautifully that Matthew Arnold says here. If a poet is dubious classic, doubtful classic, let us sift him. We have to change him. We don't study his works. If he is a false classic, let us explore him. We have to explore that writer. See, but he is a real classic. If his work belongs to the class of the very best, so you have to enjoy that poet's work. See, very important of that Matthew Arnold's achievement is the great contribution of that touchstone method to study of poetry in English literary theory. In many previous question paper, a question was asked on this, or this question was asked in matching, and also who invented touchstone method, or what do you mean by touchstone method. So we have discussed touchstone method of Matthew Arnold. Now see, Arnold's criticism of Whitehead illustrates his touchstone method. His theory that in order to judge a poet's work properly, a critic should compare it to passages taken from works of great masters of poetry, and that these passages should be applied as touchstone to other poetry. Touchstone method means, he said, to judge poet's work properly, if you want to judge a poet's work properly, or if any critic wants to judge a poet's work properly, a critic should compare that poet's work to passages taken from works of great masters of poetry, and that these passages should be applied as touchstone to the other poetry. See, next point, even a single line or selected quotation will serve the purpose. From this we see that he has shifted his position from the expressed preface to his poems in 1853. In the study of poetry, he no longer uses the acid test of action and architectonics, he became an advocate of touchstone method. See, his great touchstone passages are Helen's words about her wounded brother, Zeus addressing the horses of Pelus, suppliant Ossil's words to Priam, and from Dante, Ugolino's brave words and Beatrice's loving words to Virgil. So these are the great touchstone passages of Matthew Arnold. See, so what did that Matthew Arnold say on about Chaucer in his study of poetry? What opinions did Matthew Arnold express about Chaucer in his study of poetry? So look at that. The French romance poetry of the 13th century was extremely popular in Europe and Italy, but soon lost its popularity, and now it is important only in terms of historical study. But Chaucer, who was nourished by the romance poetry of French and influenced by the Italian royal rhyme stanza, still holds enduring fascination. There is an excellence of style and subject in his poetry, which is the quality of the French poetry lacks. So according to that Matthew Arnold, he said about French poetry here. See, what is not in French poetry, especially the 13th century French poetry, extremely popular in the European countries like Italy. But soon that poetry lost its popularity. Now it is important only in the terms of historical study. That is not important to study it because it lost its popularity. Now historical point of view, we have to study that poetry. But Chaucer, who was nourished by that romance poetry of French and influenced by the Italian royal rhyme stanza, still holds enduring fascination. There is an excellence of style and subject in his poetry, which is the quality of the French poetry. See, Arnold praises Chaucer's excellent style and manner, but he says that Chaucer cannot be called a classic since, unlike Homer, Virgil, and Shakespeare, his poetry does not have the high poetic seriousness which Aristotle regards as a mark of its superiority over the arts. See, in the study of poetry, again, that Matthew Arnold said something about the classical poets or the classical great figures, John Dryden and Alexander Pope. What he had said, we have to see now. See, the first point, the age of Dryden is regarded as superior to that of the others for sweetness of poetry. Arnold asks whether Dryden and Pope, poets of great merit, are truly the poetical classics of the 18th century. He says Dryden's postscript to the readers in his translation of the Aeneid reveals the fact that in prose writing he is even better than Milton and Chapman. See, just as the laxity in religious matters during the Restoration period was a direct outcome of the strict discipline of the Puritans, in the way, in order to control the dangerous sway of imagination found in the poetry of metaphysics, to counteract the dangerous prevalence of imagination, the poets of the 18th century introduced certain regulations. These restrictions that were imposed on the poets were uniformity, regularity, precision, and balance. These restrictions curbed the growth of poetry and encouraged the growth of prose. See, Dryden is the glorious founder and Pope is the splendid high priest of the age of the prose and reason. So the 18th century or the neoclassical age is called as the age of prose and reason of our indispensable 18th century, because this is the great presentation to prose. Their poetry was that of the builders of an age of prose and reason. Their poetry means the poetry of Dryden and Alexander Pope. So Arnold says that Pope and Dryden are not the classics of poetry, but they were the classics of prose of the 18th century. Arnold considers Thomas Gray is the classics of the 18th century. Yes, precisely. According to Arnold, Thomas Gray is the classic of the 18th century poetry. So here Matthew Arnold said that Alexander Pope and John Dryden are not the classics of poetry, but they are the classics of prose. Thomas Gray is the classics of poetry of the 18th century according to Matthew Arnold. You have to keep this point. The question was asked. So, according to Matthew Arnold, what was the critics' disinterestedness? So, in the last year KSET question paper, a meaning, the question was asked, what is the meaning of disinterestedness? See, the interest from which he would have us be free are those which militate against intellectual and moral perfection. Our judgment, he tells us, should never be swayed by the prejudices of the barbarian. The aristocrat who has spirit and politeness. The aristocrat who has spirit and politeness, but is a little inaccessible to ideas and light. So this is the critic's disinterestedness according to Matthew Arnold. See, he was a great poet and critic of the Victorian age. It means Matthew Arnold was a great poet and critic of the Victorian age. He is regarded as the first modern critic. So he is called as the critic of critics. Matthew Arnold is regarded or called as the critic of critics. According to him, the purpose of literary criticism is to know the best that is known and thought in the world and to create a current of true and fresh ideas. He greatly influenced on T.S. Eliot, F.R. Lewis and Alan Tate. See, these are T.S. Eliot, F.R. Lewis and Alan Tate. These are the progenitors of the modern criticism or new criticism. So these three grand modern critics were greatly influenced by Matthew Arnold. See, he was the founder of the sociological criticism. See, another one point you have to keep in your mind. Matthew Arnold is the founder of sociological school of criticism. T.S. Eliot praised Arnold's objective approach to critical evaluation, particularly his tools of comparison and analysis. See, Alan Tate in his essay, Tension in Poetry. Remember, Tension in Poetry is an essay written by Alan Tate, one of the main modern critics. So, the tension, it was asked in previous question paper, who does the phrase tension refer to? So that is Alan Tate wrote an essay, Tension in Poetry, imitates Arnold's touchstone method to discover tension or the proper balance between connotation and denotation in poetry. So one second, I explain this. Here Alan Tate in his essay, Tension in Poetry, imitated Arnold's touchstone method to discover tension or the proper balance between the connotation and denotation in poetry. See, connotation means the meaning of the word which is created or which is understood on the base of the context. But the denotation is the meaning which is given by the dictionary. So that is denotation. See, the social role of poetry and criticism according to Matthew Arnold. See, according to Matthew Arnold, a critic is a social benefactor and the creative artist. Before Arnold, a literary critic cared only for beauties and defects of works of art. But Arnold chose to be the educator and guardian of public opinion and propagator of the best ideas. See, for him, cultural and critical values seem to be synonymous. Scott James, comparing him to Aristotle, says that where Aristotle analyzed the work of art, Arnold analyzed the role of the critic. So here Aristotle analyzed the work of art, but here Arnold, Matthew Arnold, analyzed the role of the critics. Because what does the work of critic? According to him, a critic should do a duty of society. Arnold says that poetry is the criticism of life. Poetry is superior to philosophy, science, and religion. See, religion attaches its emotion to supposed facts, and the supposed facts are failing it. But poetry attaches its emotion to ideas, and ideas are infallible. In his view, science is incomplete without poetry. See, Arnold is a moralist, so he says that a poetry of revolt against moral ideas is revolt against life, and poetry of indifference to moral ideas is a poetry of indifference to life itself. See, poetry is superior to history since it bears the stamp of high seriousness and truth. Matthew Arnold used his grand style in his lecture on translating humor. So you can also remember the point, grand style. Like Milton, this poet Matthew Arnold also used the grand style on translating humor in 1861. See, he told the modern critics that the contemporary literature is built on the foundations of the past. So in the previous slide, we discussed, we have to take modern critics who takes the models from the and past. So here also he said that the modern critics, that contemporary literature is built on the basis of the foundation of the past and contribute to the future by continuing firm tradition. See, he urged the modern poets to look to the ancients and their great characters and themes for guidance and inspiration. So here that Matthew Arnold told that if the modern critic want to write the great poetry, so they have to take the inspiration from the past writers, past poets. And also they have to look at the ancients and their great characters and themes for guidance and the inspiration. So now I am ending this video. You have to subscribe to my channel, and also it will helpful to me also. And somebody are watching others videos on the YouTube, so you can watch any others videos. It is not objection. But before going to watch any others, anybody's video on YouTube, you should study in any textbook or in any notes about the topic. Then you have to watch that video, you will understand it. So whenever you have to read any textbook, you have to make some of your own notes. Then only you have to understand that concept. It will help you to prepare well for the examination. And when you make your own notes on literature or literary theory or any cultural study or history of language, so that is very important to you. So for the purpose of getting success in UGC NET or KSET, dear aspirants, you have to study first English literature thoroughly from Chaucer to the present age, all literary movements or literary group of poets and critical groups. Everything, every age, and also that is the literary theory from Plato to T.S. Eliot, and cultural study, all cultural study means formalism, historicism, feminism, all these theories. And also you have to look at the history of English language, and you have to look at that American literature, and also you have to study that Indian literature in English, and also you should have some knowledge of that tools and techniques used in modern pedagogy of English language, teaching of English language, and also phonetics. So if you study all these topics, and also another one I have forgotten, that rhetoric and prosody. In rhetoric and prosody, phonetics will come, and also figures of speeches will come, and also the literary literary terms and forms like that autobiography, memoir, biography, sonnet. So these terms knowledge you should have, and also some of the words were coined by some of the great critics like Hersey Parapages is coined by Clint Brooks, and that willing suspense and disbelief, it is coined by St. Coleridge. Like this type of concept you have to remember, and also you have to study some of the main important or the great classics of English language. For example, some great dramas and some great novels, some important famous poems. So you should have all these knowledge, you will get success in the examination. I think this video will be helpful to you. You are preparing well for your examination. So today I'm ending this video. On the next video, I'll come on tomorrow. Watch and prepare well. So I'm not making these videos for any earning, but I paused KSET and NUT in 2018 myself. So that's why I am preparing myself and revising and remembering all these topics myself for self-improvement and improving my language. I am preparing these videos. Thank you for watching my video, and also keep watching, and also share it, and spread the positive message about this channel, and also comment on these for improvement of